Good morning. Welcome to the House of the Lord, to St. Philip Lutheran Church here in Raleigh, North Carolina, for our service of worship and praise this Sunday morning. This is the second Sunday of Pentecost, that season of the church year in which we celebrate God's gift to us of the Holy Spirit. It now lives within each one of us and gives us the power to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and also to love our neighbors as ourselves. We are absolutely delighted that you have chosen to worship with us here this morning, either in person or online. It is a blessing to have you here. We're blessed by your presence and your participation in this worship service. We thank you, as always, for your continued financial support of our mission and ministry here at St. Philip. Put quite simply, we could not do it without you. We never take that for granted, and we are more appreciative of you than you know. You may continue to give here in person, through the mail, or via our church website, which is stphilip.org. That's st-philip.org. We welcome today a guest preacher, the Reverend Kenneth Wheeler, and his wife, Gloria. They are with us from Southern Illinois. Reverend Wheeler has written a new book. He had a book signing and a Q&A at St. Paul's Lutheran Church in Durham yesterday, and he is with us today. And we praise God for him. He was also featured in last month's Living Lutheran magazine, the national magazine for the ELCA. He has served as pastor and as a bishop assistant on synod staff in the Greater Milwaukee Synod. That's the name of the synod, right, Reverend Wheeler? Greater Milwaukee Synod. So we are honored to have the two of you here today. We also welcome Reverend Michael Dixon, who is with us from North Carolina Synod staff. He is the Synod's coordinator for social justice and advocacy ministries. So welcome Reverend and Mrs. Wheeler and Reverend Dixon. It's good to have you here with us today. At this time, we ask that you please rise as you are able for the brief order of confession and forgiveness of sin found printed on page 2 of your bulletin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who greets us in this and every season, whose word never fails, whose promise is sure. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of our neighbors. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned. We have hurt our community. We have squandered your blessings. We have hoarded your bounty. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. Righteous God, we confess that we have sinned. We have failed to be honest. We have lacked the courage to speak. We have spoken falsely. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. God is a cup of cold water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Claim the gift of God's mercy. You are freed and forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Our gathering hymn this morning is O Day of Rest and Gladness.
O Day of Rest and Gladness.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Let us pray. O God, you are the source of life and the ground of our being. By the power of your Spirit, bring healing to this wounded world and raise us to the new life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of God's holy word.
Good morning. The first reading is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 5, beginning with verse 15. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. While a wind from God swept over the face of the waters, I will return again to my place until they acknowledge their guilt and seek my face. In their distress, they will beg my favor. Come, let us return to the Lord, for it is he who has torn, and he will heal us. He has struck down, and he will build us up. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will raise us up. That we may live before him. Let us know. Let us press on to know the Lord. His appearing is as sure as the dawn. He will come to us like the showers, like the spring rains that water the earth. What shall I do with you, O Ephraim? What shall I do with you, O Judah? Your love is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Therefore, I have honed them by the prophets. I have killed them by the words of my mouth. And my judgment goes forth as the light. For I desire steadfast love and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read Psalm 50 responsively. Listen, my people, and I will speak. Israel, I will bear witness against you, for I am God, your God.
I do not accuse you because of your sacrifices. Your burnt offerings are always before me.
I will not accept a calf from your stalls, nor goats from your pens. I know every bird of the mountains, and the creatures of the fields are mine.
If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the whole world is mine, and all that is in it.
Do you think I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats? Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High. Call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you, and you shall honor me. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading for today is taken from the book of Galatians, chapter 3, beginning with verse 26. For in Christ you are all children of God through faith. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male or female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Was walking along, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. And as he sat at dinner in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came and were sitting with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciple, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when he heard this, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice. For I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners." While he was saying these things to them, suddenly a leader of the synagogue came in and knelt before him, saying, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her and she will live." And Jesus got up and followed him with his disciples. Then suddenly a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. For she said to herself, "If only I touch his cloak, I will be made well." Jesus turned and seeing her, he said, "Take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well." And instantly the woman was made well. When Jesus came to the leader's house and saw the flute players and the crowd making a commotion, he said, "Go away, for the girl is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But when the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took her by the hand, and the girl got up. And the report of this spread throughout that district, the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. After our children's message, we will hear from the Reverend Ken Wheeler. Kenneth W. Wheeler is a retired ordained pastor in the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. He is a respected elder and mentor to many pastors, young pastors, and seminarians. He published a book last year, U.S. Resurrection of American Terror, in which he shares his hopes, his sorrows, and his stories as a black pastor in a majority white denomination. A native of Jackson, Mississippi, Pastor Wheeler earned his Bachelor of Arts in Religion from Concordia College in Moorhead, Minnesota, his Master of Divinity from Trinity Lutheran Seminary in Columbus, Ohio, and a Doctor of Divinity degree, honoris causa, from Wartburg Theological Seminary. He and his wife, Gloria, have three children and are grandparents to five wonderful grandchildren. Welcome, Reverend Wheeler.
And I'm looking around and I don't see any of our young children, but we're all children of God, so I'll be talking to all of you this morning. I believe we actually might have one or two online with us at home. So, hi, kids. Today, I brought with me a very special card. Those of you who can see it, any idea what it is? A library card. Yes, this is a library card. And I just want to share with you how wonderful I think library cards are. Because anyone can get a library card. It doesn't matter how old you are. We got a library card for our 3-month-old son. He can't read, but he's got a library card. It doesn't matter how old you are, you can get a library card. It doesn't matter if you're a boy or a girl or questioning, you can get a library card. It doesn't matter what color your skin is, you can get a library card. It doesn't matter if your hair's big or small or dyed a different color or maybe you're bald, you could still get a library card. It doesn't matter where you were born, it doesn't matter who your parents are, it doesn't even matter if you like books, you can get a library card. And then once you have a library card, you are entitled to all of the benefits and services of that public library. You can check out books. You can check out movies. You can check out music. You can check. You can go with your, if you have kids, we go with our kids all the time, and they give you free arts and crafts to do in local libraries. If you didn't know that, you can go and do your own crafts. It doesn't matter how old you are. You can do crafts for free at libraries. You can use their computers to look things up, to watch videos, even to play games. There's a lot you can do in a library. There are even some libraries that let you have birthday parties inside the library. That's pretty cool. So these are all things that you can do with a library and more, all if you have a library card. And the best part about a library card, because anyone can get one, it's also 100% free. Which, the reason I bring this all up and share all this information about a library card and our libraries is because it reminds me a lot of one of our Bible readings today from the book of Galatians. In that text today, we are reminded that God's love is for everyone. It doesn't matter who you are, how you identify, God's love is for everyone. Our Bible reading tells us that we're all children of God. And so all the stuff that we sometimes use to identify ourselves, whether that's putting ourselves down or building ourselves up to make ourselves feel better and more important than others, it doesn't really matter to God. What matters is that God loves us, each of us and every single one of us, just the way we are. And just like you can get a library card for free, God's love is also free for everyone. You may not even like God at the moment. Just like you may not like books, you can still get a library card even if you don't like books. And God's love is for you even if you're mad at God or don't really love God back right now. So our library card reminds me a lot about God's love because it's for anyone and everyone. Anybody can get one, and there's a lot that comes with the benefits of having a library card or with having God's love in your life. And so that's our reminder today, is that anytime you think about a library, I want you to remember that God's love, just like a library card, is for everyone. With that, I'd love for you to please repeat after me in prayer. Dear God, thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
And for loving everyone.
And for loving everyone.
No matter what.
No matter what.
Please help us.
Please help us.
To love others like you love us.
To love
others
like you love us.
We love
you. We love
you. Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you very much, everyone.
Good morning. So at the first service, Kai, thank you again for that wonderful children's message. And yes, we are all children of God, but at the first service, we did have young children who were up. And so as Kai is talking about the benefits of the library, and he says, you know, you can even have parties in the libraries. And I think one of the young kids said, but yeah, you're supposed to be quiet in libraries. Right? I want to rehearse for us again the words from Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 28, and I am reading from the Message. Paul says, in Christ's family, there can be no division into Jew and non-Jew, slave and free, male and female. Among us, you are all equal. That is, we are all in a common relationship with Jesus Christ. Also, since you are God's family, then you are Abraham's famous descendants, heirs according to the covenant promises. And then in chapter 1 of that same epistle, Paul would lay out the authority by which he speaks. He says, my authority for writing to you does not come from any popular vote of the people, nor does it come through the appointment of some human higher up. It comes directly from Jesus, who is the Messiah, and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. I am God commissioned, Paul says, so I greet you with these words, grace and peace. We know the meaning of these words because Jesus Christ rescued us from this evil world by offering himself as a sacrifice for our sins. God's plan is that we all experience that rescue, that we all experience that redemption, that we all experience that freedom. And then Paul concludes his letter with these words, a shout of glory. Glory be to God, glory be to God, glory be to God forever. Let the church say amen. Amen. I read these words and I am struck right away by white slave owners who could miss these words, although not by accident, and quickly cite Paul where he exhorts slaves to be obedient unto their masters, to support the sinful and egregious institution of slavery. This Galatian text is one that we are well acquainted with in the church. It has been referred to as the Magna Carta of the church, this great document of freedom. And yet we understand as people of God, as baptized people of God, we understand that our freedom is rooted in God's grace. We understand that our freedom is relegated to the body of Jesus Christ, rooted in Jesus, this Jesus who has granted us freedom, this Jesus who calls us to live in freedom, this Jesus who calls us to walk in freedom. And we understand that this is not a willy-nilly kind of freedom, not a kind of freedom that allows us to live as we please or to live any kind of way. No, this is freedom that is centered in God's immeasurable grace. Paul says, we have been saved by grace, by this redemptive act of Jesus dying on a cross. This one who gave up his life freely, and this one who commands us now, you and me, to live in that same kind of freedom. We are free to love our neighbor. We are free to serve our neighbor. We are free to care for our neighbor. We are free to do justice to our neighbor. And so the prophet Michael reminds us what God has shown us, what is good. And what does the Lord require of us but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God? And notice that doing justice and loving kindness and walking humbly with our God are not optional. This is a mandate, but it's a mandate that grows out of our freedom. We are free to love God with our whole heart, with our whole mind, with all of our body, and we are free to love the neighbor as we love ourselves. And yet Paul is speaking, as he writes this letter, he's speaking to a tension that has arisen in the body of Christ. He says, some of you have turned to a different gospel, which is no gospel at all. You've let some people with smooth sounding words mess with your minds in order to convince you that the gospel alone is not enough, that God and God's grace are not enough. Who messed with your mind? I can't believe, he says, your fickleness, how easily you have turned traitor to him who called you by grace, embracing a variant message. You know, it's a message that is completely other. It's alien. It's foreign. It's a lie about God. Today, the church has been greatly influenced by an Americanized Jesus. This Jesus has been shaped by capitalism and the profit motif. This Jesus is a lie. For we hear in this version of Jesus, in this prosperity gospel, which turns Jesus into a strategy for becoming wealthy, but this prosperity gospel is a lie about God. This Jesus has nothing whatsoever to do with the Jesus who hung on a cross on that God-forsaken Friday. You remember that story? He hung for 3 hours. They whipped him. They pierced his body. They traumatized his body. They spat on him. They cursed him. One of the thieves who hung on one side of Jesus taunted him. You remember the story. Looked at him and said, "If you are who you say you are, show us. Come down from that cross. Save yourself and save us." But you remember that Jesus would not move because he was God's love, because he was God's son. He stayed there and he died. This Jesus, the one who showed up after the resurrection, came a second time. You remember, because Thomas was not there the first time. And he shows up. Thomas is looking at him. And Thomas said, "I won't believe unless I can see the wounds of crucifixion in your body." And Jesus said, "Touch, feel. I am the one who was crucified. I am the one who so loved the world that I died for you. I am the one," as I was being taunted and ridiculed and whipped and urged to get off of the cross, "I stayed there and died. Thomas, I am he." This Jesus. When Donald Trump was running for president in 2015, it was reported that 81% of white evangelical Christians voted for him. 81% of white evangelical Christians voted for him. 81% Christian voting for a man who was an avowed white nationalist and white supremacist. 81% of white Christians voted for him. I wondered who these people were. I wondered who was their Jesus. This gospel of white supremacy is still strong in 2023. And it has always been prevalent in America. But I tell you this, as I stand in this pulpit this morning, that white supremacy is a lie. It is a lie about God. It is a lie about the man who died on that cross 2,000 years ago. Jesus called us to live in truth. Jesus calls us to live in the grace of Christ. And yet some of us are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. And Paul says, who tricked you? Who got into your head? A better question, who got into your heart? Who got into your spirit? The gospel of prosperity is no gospel at all. The gospel of white supremacy and racism is no gospel at all. The gospel of militarism and guns is no gospel at all. And yet there are more guns in America than there are people, because for many people, their guns have become their gods. We are more loyal to the Second Amendment than we are to God's Jesus. And if truth be told, if Jesus were to return at this very moment in our national life, this Jesus who hung and bled from a cross because he loved the world, if he were to return at this very moment and said to us Christians, give up your guns, I believe that Jesus would have a fight on his hands, because our guns have become our gods. But this is true. The gospel of mass destruction, the gospel of weapons, the gospel of consumerism and plantation capitalism is no gospel at all. The gospel of white supremacy, the gospel of white nationalism is no gospel at all. The gospel of white supremacy has as its goal to separate and cause divisiveness. And yet there are people in the church who have wrapped themselves in this gospel of whiteness because they believe that it is redemptive. They believe that it will save them. They believe that there is something benevolence about it, but they've been sold a bill of goods that have been wrapped in a lie. This is what we know. This is what is foundational. This is what we believe as baptized people of God. God is love. That's foundational. That's the truth that sets us free. God is love. And in God, there are no boundaries. In God, there is no smallness. And yet there are some among us who may confess this, but who do not believe this. And Paul says, without equivocation, they are enemies of the cross. Well, who is he talking about? He's talking about us, brother. That's who he's talking about. He's talking to Christians. That's who he's talking about. He's talking about anyone who sits in church with a grudge in his or her heart against a fellow member. He says, those folks are enemies of the cross. Anyone who does not show kindness, anyone who is not generous, anyone who does not show forgiveness, does not have the capacity to forgive, is an enemy of the cross. Anyone captivated by hatred, captivated by white supremacy, is an enemy of the cross. God is love. And God's love is extravagance. God so loved the world that he gave himself to the world, holding nothing back because he loved us. A few years ago, I was a presenter at a church conference that was sponsored by the largest foundation in the state of Wisconsin. The conference was held outside of Milwaukee, which is where we lived, and the focus of the congregation, the focus of the conference was on growing congregations. I assumed that I was invited to be one of the speakers because our church, though in the heart of the city, located in one of the poorest zip codes in that city, still one of the poorest zip codes in that city, in spite of that, we were growing. I spoke for about 20 minutes. I talked about things that were vital and relevant to our ministry, things that were life-giving. We operated a free clinic that served 400 uninsured people a week. We offered a hot meal program that fed between 300 and 500 people a week. We offered a Bible study not attached to the meal program that drew 100 people a week. These were people whose lives, whose backs were up against the wall. They were, some of them were prostitutes, still active in their profession. Some of them were drug addicts, still active in their addiction, who gathered to hear about this God who loved them unconditionally. I thought it was a fine and clear presentation of our ministry. And when I was done, I was certain that I would get a lot of good questions about more specifics. I was certain that would be the case as I looked out over the audience and sensing interest and affirmation from what had just been described. But when the moderator asked if there were questions for me, there was a young man who jumped to his feet immediately almost, and he asked the question. There was anger in his voice. There was judgment in his voice. He obviously got stuck early in my presentation as I was describing that we were a congregation that had a long history of welcoming people who were gay and lesbian to worship and to participate fully in our ministry. That young man heard nothing else. He heard nothing else. He missed the heart of what we did. He missed what our ministry was about. But he also missed Jesus. He missed Jesus. He missed the heart of Jesus. He missed that much of the church's outreach involved walking with the poorest of the poor and the unemployed people in the community who were never afforded dignity or justice. I am so grateful that I grew up in the 1950s in a Jim Crow South, and as painful as that reality could be at times, I learned never to put people down based upon some prefabricated notion of what it meant to be a human being. And I learned, and I continue to learn, to never use the Bible as a hammer. And so on that day, I felt great sadness for that young man because of the question, but more importantly, I felt sadness because of the judgment he made about people that he did not believe belonged in the church based upon their sexual orientation. I felt great sadness for him because he missed the heart of Jesus. I feel great sadness for people in this country who have attached their ideology and who have staked their lives on the idolatry of white supremacy and white nationalism because, in effect, they have missed the gospel. They have missed Jesus. God so loved the world. And I am so thankful that God did not file any exceptions. He did not say, love all people except black people. Love all people except migrants. Love all people except those who are gay and lesbian and transgender. No, our God did not say that. The Bible declares unequivocally that God so loved the world, and I'm so thankful that that's the kind of God who looked down from heaven, came down from heaven after he had finished creating the world with a word, came down and played in some dirt and fashioned human beings, blew into them his breath, stepped back and said, it is good. God so loved the world. That's the God we serve. That's the God who is true. That's the God that we ought to stake our lives on each and every day. That's the God who ought to light our hearts every day. I am 70 years of age, moving into the autumn of my life, and I've seen a lot of stuff. Growing up in the state of Mississippi, I've seen a lot of stuff. I met a lot of people. Some of them I almost hated. Were it not were it not for the story that I heard first from my mother talking to me about this Jesus. Son, this is what love means. Not just to love your friends, but to love even your enemies. And I heard my mother pray every morning at 5 a.m, every morning on her knees, praying for me, praying that I would not grow up to hate people who did not look like me, but also praying for people who did not look like her. Mom, why do you do that? Son, because God's love is real. And the moment that you begin to let hatred take over, then you have discounted God's love. Let the people of God say, amen. Amen.
We ask that you please rise as you are able as we join together in singing our hymn of the day, Just As I Am, Without One Plea.
Together in trust and hope, we profess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Trusting in God's abundant mercy, let us offer our prayers for a world in need. We pray, O God, for the Church. Unite us with any on the margins, that the whole world recognizes that your mercy is greater than our human capacity to restrict it. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, O God, for creation. Tend forests and fields and safeguard all cattle, birds, and wild animals. Preserve lakes, rivers, and oceans and send rains to water the earth. Revive lands recovering from natural disasters. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, O God, for the nations. Awaken in our leaders compassion for people who have too often felt forgotten or neglected, and inspire policy solutions that promote equity and inclusion. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, O God, for all who are in need. Accompany anyone enduring chronic illness, any who suffer in secret, and those grieving a loved one's death. Send healing for all who plead for relief from sickness or pain. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, O God, for the eradications of racial hatred. On this week, when we commemorate the Emmanuel Nine, we implore you to cast out the demons of white supremacy that make us believe lies about ourselves and our neighbors. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks, O God, for Barnabas and all the saints. Renew our faith that you can do what you have promised and raise us with all our beloved dead to new life. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we lift to you now the names of all those for whom we have special concern. We pray for healing and wisdom and peace.
May all of us hear your truth, O Lord. For the people of Ukraine,
God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And now may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of God's peace with one another now, as well as with those online via the back cameras or more personally up at the front monitor. God's peace be with you. Paul, may God's peace be with you.
Can't call you teacher anymore.
Hey, Songbird.
Hey, peace be with you.
Actually, it's a music bird. Sweet.
Well, I heard him preach it in the early service. He changed a little. There's more than that.
Exactly.
It's a whole society.
But see, you can't have white people.
There's a reaction going on too.
Peace
the thing, it's not too party, is it?
St. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, the point, my brothers and sisters, is this: if you sow sparingly, you will reap sparingly. But if you sow bountifully, you will reap bountifully. For God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance so that you may always have enough of everything in order that you may provide abundantly for every good work in God's house and in God's kingdom. If you have not already given online, we invite you to join with me now in making presentation of our tithes and offerings unto the Lord via the offering plates in the back. We thank you so much. Please rise as you're able. We join together in singing our offertory, "Let the vineyards be fruitful, Lord." Pray. God of field and forest, sea and sky, you are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation and multiply your graciousness in us.
that the world may be fed with your love, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
We celebrate together now the Lord's Supper, the feast of Holy Communion. Now may the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Scripture tells us that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we now pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. All people are called to Christ's table. Come, eat what is good. You may be seated for the distribution. All are invited to, all are welcome at the Lord's table. Small children are invited forward for a blessing. We do have a gluten-free option available. Please let me know as I approach if that is your preference. And please follow directions found printed in your bulletin and of the ushers. Please rise to receive our post-communal blessing. Now may the eating of Christ's body and the drinking of his blood strengthen, keep, and preserve you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please remain standing for a couple of brief announcements and mission opportunities. Please do not forget to... Thank you. You saw me looking. I normally look confused, but I'm normally not that obvious about it. Please remember to submit a picture of yourself and or your family to the church office. We are working on our new pictorial directory. There are further details in the bulletin, and if you need assistance of any kind, you may ask our church secretary, Jane. Reverend Wheeler, we are honored that you were with us this morning. We thank you for your words, for your wisdom, for your loving kindness, for your service for many decades to our greater church in the kingdom of God. Thank you. Him with an honorarium, obviously. I don't spend it all in one place now.
Cracker Barrel is my favorite.
Cracker Barrel, that's a good one. That's a good one. And now receive the benediction of our Lord. And now may the God who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed bless, keep, and sustain you now until the end of the age. Amen. Our sending hymn this morning is O Word of God Incarnate. Partners in ministry, what is our mission? Jesus asked that we love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, and mind, and that we love our neighbors as ourselves. Answering that call, may you go in peace and share the love of Christ. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Piano concert last night with this pair.
Oh, nice.
The 10th.